Assembly language tutorials, chapter 8, and we have several parts in that, so we start off. So I have slides, modules and some demos. Now this chapter is actually the core chapter, if you will, of this entire course. Here we talk about procedures. We had talked about procedures before, and we have seen that when you call a procedure, so the next instruction after that is actually saved in the stack, and then when you come back, so you finally you get to that point which was the next instruction and you continue from there. So your program is running, you branch off to another procedure and you come back and you continue. So we have seen those things. So this video would be more about how we call the functions, how these variables inside the functions, or in our case assembly, so we call procedures instead of functions, so how the stack grows, shrinks, stuff like that. So this is the first part, and here there is a concept called stack frame. So I have written a little description there, and that's all there is to it. Like, you have a stack which is a region in the RAM, this hardware RAM that you purchase while the operating system is running, so it uses some of the portions of that RAM, and inside that when you call a procedure, so you have to know the next instruction after that procedure, you have to store that into the stack, and then after calling the procedure you will have local variables. Sometimes you want to save the registers also. Suppose you have saved two numbers, let's say 4 and 5, into EAX register and EBX register. Now you invoke the procedure, so you will have access to EAX and EBX register inside the procedure. You could use that. Suppose you are doing something there and you modify, you need to use EAX register, but you can't. And if you use that, you will override the values, the previous values. So if you need them, you could save those registers in the stack, and then later on you can operate on that, and eventually you could pop the values in the same order into those registers back. So suppose you are doing push EAX, now you use the register EAX for various purposes, and then you do pop EAX, so the stored value would be retrieved back. I'll show a demo, but this is just a basic theory I'm covering, and here we have a demo. All these solutions, source code is available in GitHub, and you could download it, play around with this, do more hands-on, implement your own procedures, you will learn a lot. So here is quite a lot of assembly, so I will let's see what we have here. Here we have two numbers, so I'm calling this guy over here, this add num, so which is here, so it's nothing but this is called kind of a, I'm saving where I came from, the base register, because I need to use them here. You see the point? Like, you save your registers into the stack and then you operate on that and then you pop it, so you get back the old value. Let's run this demo. Let's see add num, and I will have a breakpoint over here, debug it. So now I have 6, so I stored this 6 and 5 into the stack, so I stored 6 first and then 5, so but here I am referencing the 12, so I should be able to access this guy, because what happens is memory is you start from the higher address and go towards the lower address, so 6 was stored before 5, so it would have a higher address than 5, that's why this 12, it gives me this guy over here. Now why it is 12? Because we know that when we invoke a procedure like this guy over here, we have to save the address of this instruction, it takes 4 bytes, and then you have another 4 bytes, which is a number, another 4 bytes, so now you are at 12. So in order to go to higher address, now you were already there at the higher address. Now you saved these things, so you are going towards the lower address. So in order to get back the value, you have to add instead of subtract. I will show it, this in the debugger as well, immunity debugger, but here just to see that our demo works. So we have 6 over here, and now 8, which would give me 5, so it's B. So if we open a calculator, like off the top of my head, I never calculate anything, I use a calculator. So B, as you can see, it's decimal, it's 11, so we got our number. I'll stop debugging this and I will open up my immunity debugger and we will talk more about that on that. And you must install this immunity debugger. It's a very useful tool for debugging purpose and see the exactly what's happening in the memory and stuff like that. The program is paused. I will run it. Now I need to set the breakpoints. So if you see over here, our instruction are there. 6, 5, and then we are making the call. So it would go to this location 201061. So 201061 is this guy, push EBP, and that's exactly what we have here. So what you see here is what you get in the immunity, exactly like that, because we are writing in assembly anyway, so we would see the one-on-one mapping. We have all the things, EBP and 12 and 8, return 8. We have like exactly in that order. So now you see this gray area, so we are there. And now I will set a breakpoint here. 2 and 3 and 4. Two zero one zero six one. I'll clear off these. 201061. Breakpoint there. Return 8. So when we return 8, I will talk about what return means in next few minutes. But right now I'm setting the breakpoints. So when we return from that. In the previous video, we have seen that the return would take you back where you were. So we will come to this area over here, 41. So let's run this. Now, immunity, I must say that probably I have covered in previous video. I do not remember. So we have 4 sections here. This is our disassembled code. Towards the right, we have our registers, EX, ECX, and others. This is our hex dump. If you open the same binary in a hex editor, we would see the same this way, and towards the right we have our stack. So we go to ESP, it is the top of the stack, and it's not that top of the stack means the top of the memory. There are many other things. You see over here, we have some values also. These are for other functions and most of them are empty, and you could go down also. So if you get lost, just right click and go to EBP. So where EBP is pointed at right now, you will come there and go to ESP. So we are here. This is the top of our stack. Now we are here, the gray part. So the current execution is stopped there. So if I run it once, so we would come to this. So I press the play button. Now we are here, push 6, but we have not pushed the 6 into the stack because of our breakpoint. So now look closely over this area, 654. Now if I run this instruction, so the value is pushed into the stack. If I run one more, so now we have 5. And now I will be branching from this to this guy. So what will happen is this address, this 41, it has to be stored in the stack so that I could come back there. So we have 5 here, so I run it. Now our 41 address is stored there, and now we have branched here. So push EBP. So push EBP instruction. Now EBP, what we have here, we have 010FF7D4 towards the registers, so that would be pushed to here, and exactly we got that. Now we are moving ESP to EBP. Now if you see here, ESP is FF7B4, which is this guy over here, and this is our EBP. Left is ESP and right is EBP, but EBP is not pointing anywhere. EBP is here only. So basically what's happening is EBP is D4, which is this guy. So this is the base pointer. So this section, this is the stack pointer and this is the base pointer, and of course we can see that little bracket over there. Now once we run this instruction, move EBP ESP, so the ESP would be loaded into EBP. Why we need that? Because now we have branched into another procedure, so we need to have its own stack. Now our ESP is and EBP, they are both the same. So if someone tells you that in the stack EBP points to the base of the stack and ESP points to the top of the stack, but in this case, like if you see in the register, we have the same value, so where the hell is our stack? Don't we have any stack? No, that's not correct. So you know, it's just a theoretical concept that EBP points to the base of the stack and ESP points to the top of the stack. If they are equal, then where is our stack? It's still there. So these are just registers and we could manipulate them as we want. Now we move EAX and EBP C. So what is EBP? EBP is B4 and now plus C. So if I add B4 and C, so let's see what happens. B4 plus C, it will be C0, right? It will be C0, which is this guy. You got my point? This is this guy. So 6 would be loaded into EAX. So now we have nothing in EAX, some other values. So if I run this instruction, we got that in 6. We got EAX filled with 6. Now next instruction, EBP plus 8, which would be 5, because this was 6. And if you see the assembly code over here, so EBP plus 12, EBP plus 8, and 12 in hex, it means C. So now EBP EX has 6, so now EBP plus 8 is 5, so it is added to EX, so it will become 11, but we will see the hex equivalent. So now it is B. So I'll run this again. So exactly we got 11 there. And now we have to restore EBP. So this is what I was talking about. Now top of the stack is D4. If you rewind this video, go back a few seconds, so this was the initial EBP value. Now we have to go back. Now we have done what we wanted to do in our procedure, so we have to get back and restore our stack. So that's what's happening. Otherwise how we would know that where the hell we were executing something, now we branched into a procedure, we did something, now we come back, we should have the exact stack condition we had before. This is what's happening. So pop EBP, so EBP would be restored. If I run this, so now EBP got D4 and now return 8. So now it's good time to talk about return 8. What return 8 does is it takes the whatever is at the top of the stack. Now we have 00201041, that address, it would be injected to EIP register. This guy over here, it would be injected to that. So remember this, 1041. Now EIP would be overridden with 1041, and 8 means it will be decremented. No, I'm sorry, it will be incremented, and we will come back 4 bytes and 4 bytes. So we'll reach here. So we will place this thing 1041 into EIP. And we'll skip 8 bytes, which is the 8 here, and our stack would reach here. So when I run this button, this play button, which I'm going to do, what will happen is this thing is going to be placed inside EIP, and this will become our top of the stack. So let's see that. You have to now look at two things over here as well and here as well. So let's remember this one more time. 1041. And you see exactly that happened. So now we are here. We pushed something into the stack, we branched it, now we are here. So if I remove that, if we could see the breakpoints. So now this gray section, it shows the current executing instruction, so that's what's happening. So this is actually the stack works. Now the variables that we created, we pushed something, we pushed the EBP, we restored that, and the return address, all this part, we didn't have any local variables, all these things, they make the stack frame. So stack frame is kind of a region in the stack itself. Before I talk about calling conventions, I will kill this debugger. You would probably need to watch this video a couple of more times and follow along and that see that download this immunity debug. It's very useful tool, and this is kind of an initial memory analysis that we are doing. So it's really helpful. Now calling conventions. We have several type of calling conventions, like fast call, then vector call, then Pascal call, so many. Santa Claus and so many. But in here we mostly talk about C calling convention, which is also called cdecl, and std call, which is called the standard call. All the Windows operating system, it's composed of Win APIs, and they all follow standard call. So these are the two functions that we are going to talk about. Now arguments are pushed into the reverse order because of we just saw that. So what we push would be stored in the higher order first, so it would be the reverse way. So you have to access it backwards. The further you want to go, the more you have to add, like we had seen over here, like 12, you add 12 first before you add 8. So in C++ or Python, you know that, right? 0 1 2 3, the index of a list or an array. So it's not like that, you have to go backwards. This is a little tricky one. You will get used to it. So you could have your own calling conventions also. I would encourage the viewer to do a research on this. And even I have done some POCs, like mixing C calling convention and std call. So it's like tricky, but it is possible. So, but these two are like the industry standard. So I would rather stick with them, because our end goal would be to reverse engineer binaries after covering assembly. So we would pay attention to how the std call works and C calling, which is used by the functions like printf and scanf and stuff like that, because those are part of C programming language. Now local variables, we could have a local variable also, so I have a demo on that. So this is our local proc, so I will run this. This would be interesting, you would love it. So if you like assembly, you must like assembly in order to be a reverse engineer. So local proc, let's run this. Let's read what it does. So it's loading 8 into ESP, it's subtracting actually. That's okay. EBP minus 4, it's loading value 5. It's loading value 5 into D word PTR EBP minus 4. So this is a EBP, then you minus 4. So this area, you would get 5 there. So let's see that. And this guy, it is loading 6 into that. And then over here, we are restoring the ESP. And then we are popping the EBP. So let's open a debugger actually, immunity debugger, we will see this. Part 1, plate, now these are our functions. We have to find our local proc, which is sub ESP8, so this is the uniqueness, we could look for it. Yes, we have over here. this breakpoint is still there. So push EBP instruction starts there. Okay, so local proc starts here. This is 6E, so we are coming from here. So I'll set a breakpoint here, 6E. So this is our procedure. Let's break everything. Our breakpoint got hit. Now we are at local proc, which is we are actually here in the memory. Now this is our next instruction, 49. So before we branch to this location, we have to store this 49 into stack. That got saved and we have now branched. Push EBP. EBP is 40. This is 49. Now it is 40, so EBP got pushed there. Move ESP to EBP, because we are creating our own stack there, so the stack frame there. So EBP, and now we are here. Our ESP is 30. Now we are going to subtract 8 bytes, right? We are going to subtract 8 bytes. So 30 now becomes 2C and 28. So these we got 5 and 6. Now after we got that, this is our 5 and this is our 6. These values, and now we run it. So you saw that thing got changed. Let me run that again. We are here now, local proc, push EBP, subtract, we got 5 and 6. These are some previous values. So EBP minus 4, now EBP is 88, so minus 4 will be 84. So we are talking about this. So we are going to load 5 into this. So this 6 is going to change. So look closely, I play it. So that got changed. And now this, now our EBP is 88 again, so I subtract 8. So this location, this 5, we would get that overwritten with 6. Now why those 5 and 6 came? Probably because of something happened before, like over here or somewhere. Maybe we didn't clear off all these things. So what happens is, since we executed these instructions and we came here, so these values, even if we incremented stack by 8, so we went backwards towards the higher memory, but still these were there actually. So probably I could show you that. So I would have to set a breakpoint for add ESP8. So let's find that in the debugger. Restart it. Now we are here, so I will set a breakpoint there. I run it. I will run it. So our stack ESP is pointing at E0, which is this guy. But if you scroll, you could see that the 5 and 6 are still kicking around there. So what do you mean there? Garbage collection hasn't happened yet. This is the beauty about memory. Like, it keeps the values there somewhere. It's unless you free them, so there is no way those would be there. Unless our program terminates, it would be there. You could just move around stack and stuff like that, because the memory is initialized. So in the computer architecture, you would learn later on, I would probably make videos on that. So what happens is the memory keeps refreshing. There are some kind of digital logic, if you will, so I wouldn't give too much information to confuse you. But think of it, there is a mechanism in the RAM which refreshes those values. So the 5 and 6 would be kicking there always. So the garbage collection that you see in Java and C++, those are not real. Like, those are bullshit. Let's move along. Now we have push and push and subtract. The subtract instruction, actually what's happening is now we are higher address in the memory, higher offset, if you will. Now we are subtracting, so we are moving our ESP towards the lower address by 8 bytes, so we get 2 areas free there. So that is why our EBP -4, which is D9, so this will be changing and this will be changing. So I will run this and I will change those values. Actually, you know, I will have 3 and 2. Probably it would make more sense. Open up the file. Now after you build that, all our breakpoints are gone. So now we have to find where we were. This was one breakpoint, 6E. This is our 6E. How do I know that? I see just this one, 0084106E. So this is where we are. You know, immunity, it makes those bracket kind of thing. So just to show you that, that's a procedure. And but this bracket, it keeps changing. So you have to watch out for that. Now ESP, we are here. Push EBP. Push override EBP, create the local space for local variables. Now you would see that the 6 will be changed with 3. That got changed with 3. Actually, this is a kind of a location in the memory. So using dword PTR, you could override that address with these values. So that's what's happening there. PTR is a pointer, but it's actually not a pointer. It's actually, we have covered this PTR before. So suppose you are moving something like a size which is less than to a destination, which is the destination is bigger, so you use this thing. Now 2, and now we have done that. Now move ESP and pop ESP and then return. So that covers our local variable actually. So this is how you create a space for local variables and you put values. So you would say that what kind of nonsense is this? Like, I declare local variable like I equals 10 or J equals 25. This is not a local variable. This is manipulating the ESP, creating addresses, creating a space, like which the space is already there. So just manipulating the ESP and storing some value into the addresses, is that local variable? Exactly, you are right. That's what's happening here. So all those local variables that you see in programming languages, again, those are bullshit. References, the same way we have created local variables, we could push the address of an array into memory. So we have talked about array in great detail. It's nothing but a contiguous memory location. So if you could get the address of that, now you could access that with this dereference, the square brackets, and you could get those values into your registers. Load effective address. So now how about you create an array in the procedure itself? So how would you get its own address? So let me show if I have a demo for that. Okay, LIA demo, load effective address. So now I'm subtracting 12 bytes from ESP, so I'm creating a bunch of kind of a I wouldn't say a bunch of space because space is already there. So let's think of it kind of a, I'm creating a region that I'm going to use later. So it's quite a big one. So how do we get the address of that into ESI? So when you're processing an array, you need to work with ESI. So this way you could get address of EBP minus 10. So whatever is stored at EBP minus 10, that address would be stored to this one. And then you could dereference ESI like I have done here, and you would be able to move these things. So let's see a demo on that. immunity debugger, run it. Let's clear off all these things. Now this video is actually important. Also, probably you wouldn't grasp everything in the first watch, so you pause it, play around, come back, watch it a couple of times. This assembly language, this is the core section of that, so you never skip it, understand it fully. So that's why I'm making this video like in a full length, so it could get long. Let's find our procedure there, LIA demo. How do I know that? We have LIA instruction there, so let's look for LIA. This is LIA. So this is our procedure. Let's set breakpoints. Now this came from 99C. Let's find 9C. This over here, so we set a breakpoint there. What I'm saying is, while doing memory analysis, you have to deal with the assembly. So how do you get back? Now the reverse engineering tools like IDA Pro, so I will have a demo on that also soon, how to use that. You will get this thing actually in IDA Pro, but you have to run a debugger also at the same time, and you have to see like how they are changing. Just by looking at a code, you cannot know for sure what's going on, so you have to do the memory analysis also. So you need debugger and disassembler if you are reverse engineering or you're finding vulnerabilities in software. So you need debugger and disassembler both at the same time. So that is why I'm jumping back and forth between IDE and our debugger. We have reached a certain level that we do not need to set up breakpoints in Visual Studio, right? So we are here. This is the return address. This is the top of the stack. So that would get stored there. 5A, brilliant. Now we are here. So I will skip through it because you are already smart, you know this. So now EBP is over here, 20. So 20 minus A, what do we get? If you could do this thing in your head, probably you could do a great things, but I use calculator. So it is 16. So AFF 8, 16. Mm-hmm. 16 or 1C. Let me calculate that again. Let me give the whole value. AFF 820 minus A. AFF 816. I'm trying to find EBP minus A. So let's see what the debugger gives us. It's going to load that thing into ESI. So let's see what it gives. So our ESI is this one. 1005. So it gave 16. Probably you check this. So I'm not able to find that address. So I'm not sure that this A thing, where it is going to be loaded. Okay, I got it. You know what's the problem? See, this is 18, right? So this is 4 bytes actually. So 14, 15 and 16. So 0000. So that's where our location is. So what's going to happen is what is there at 814 is 0000, 00 and 0B. So 00, the second 00 is actually going to be overridden with 0A. So let's see that. Move ECX. Ah, I couldn't find it there. So this 41, ESI was 816. So this is our 0A. So let's run it couple of more times, so then we could trace back. Now we have a loop. Our 41 is starting. You see that thing is getting overridden. Our loop counter is 2. So we started off here. So 14, 15 and 16. So it's actually within the memory itself, within that 4 bytes. So we have 14 and 16. So these are not aligned properly. That's why it was a little bit tricky to see that. But we could clearly see that it was 14. So 14 and 2 bytes. So let's skip through it and let's run that, rerun that. Now we are here. Okay, so now we are inside the function. We are at LIA. So EBP is 44. 44 minus A would be 44 minus A is 3A. So our ESI. So what would be this address? C. So this would be, this is backwards, so we would be somewhere here, the second byte. So we have to like play around with this for some time, so eventually we'll know that the exact bytes where they are landing. So because these are not properly aligned, that's why it's a little bit hard to see that. Now 41, it started here. So 38 and that one. So our value is being overridden with this ASCII character. Now A is actually 41 in hex. So that thing is stored into this location. So the byte PTR is actually a pointer. So it's not a pointer, but it's, think of it as a location. So the hex value of A is actually stored into this. So if you keep running it, so you would see an incremental thing going on, and eventually 54, then F8, then F4 and 00 would be overridden. So those are being filled as well. So I hope that makes sense. So watch this video a couple of times, like I'm reiterating myself, and play around with this debugger. Sometimes it is hard to find the offsets, so but if you spend quite some time, you would get that. So I wouldn't probably dig too much and debug it on the fly, so but you will get that eventually. So LIA instruction is actually used when we have a, like inside the procedure itself we have an array, so we want to operate on that. Like what we are doing is we are creating space, we are filling it with A's, so that's when you use LIA instruction. Enter and leave. Now in all the demos, if you see here, push EBP and move EBP ESP, then pop EBP, then again, and then again, and then again, and then again, these things are repeating. So instead of that, if we could have something like this, enter takes two parameters, 00, because we do not have any local variable there, but this is our local variable. So I will not screw this demo, let's screw this one. Here we are not having any local variable, here we are having 4 bytes, so 2 local variables. Here we are having like 12 bytes, so we have a lot of local variables there. So while passing this instruction, enter N and M, so save EBP into stack, so this is prologue and epilogue. It means this thing is actually prologue, this is epilogue. Here you are saving the register for restoring the stack, and here you are actually restoring the stack. So you could have enter N and M. So these values, now these are the local variables and this is the nesting level. Suppose you have more calls and you want to nest things, so that's when you use n and m. So this function, it looks like we do not have anything, so I will place it here 0 0, and then I will have a leave there, leave, and then I will build it. Syntax error, brilliant. Let's build it again. It was a common mistake. I guess we have fat fingered something there. Oh, so we skipped that part. Okay, so let's get back to inter. We do not have any local variables there, so I could safely put inter 00 leave. So if I do this, it's actually going to do the exact same thing. So let's build it. Let's see if we are lucky enough. Indeed we are. So add nums. Let's run a debugger. Run it. This would be the first function, because we see that we have pushed 6 5, so add nums is the next one. So let's set a breakpoint there, 3c. And we have to go to D31061 here. We have enter and leave coming up there. So let's see how it behaves. Let's run it. Enter 00. Now look closely over here. 41. So you saw that something got saved there. What got saved is nothing but the registers. Actually what happened is few things happened like simultaneously. These two things happened. Push EBP, then ESP overrode EBP. So what was the value before EBP? So let me rerun this and show you that. We are here. Now EBP is 74 and ESP is 54. So here we have 41. So now we will have 74 there. We got 74 and ESP and EBP are equal. So you see that what we have over here, these two lines, are actually taken care by these things. So in a similar fashion, the leave will also work. So this will be there still kicking in. We move it, we add it. So we got B over there. This is the value, 6 plus 5 is 11. And then this is going to pop it. So it popped it. And now return 8. So 8 is the return instruction. It will save the top of the stack, load it into EIP, and then increment the stack by that much amount. So we go back where we came from. We always start from higher addresses in the memory. We go towards left, towards the lower region. When we give data, we come backwards from lower towards higher. We just saw that in our array. So we saw that 41 being filled from higher towards lower. So I guess that's all I have for this video, and I hope you enjoyed this video. And the key thing is you have to run these things. Like, I can cover only so much, but it cannot be exhaustive. So you have to run these things, learn these concepts, play around. And if you have any questions, ask me, and I would be making more videos, so stay tuned and subscribe. Have a good day. Bye bye.